Okay, so then we'll switch to the second speaker, Professor Thomas Schultes from ETH Zurich and CSCS. Thomas received his PhD in physics in 1994 from ETH Zurich. After postdoctoral fellowship at Lawrence Livermore National Laboratory, he joined Oak Ridge National Laboratory in 1997. In 2002, he became a group leader of the computational material science group in ORNL, Computer Science and Mathematics Divisions. And in 2005, he was appointed to the lead of the Nanomaterials Theory Institute of ORNL. Since October 2008, Thomas holds a chair in computational physics in ETH Zurich and directs the Swiss National Supercomputer Center, CSCS, in Lugano. So he currently holds a visiting distinguished scientist appointment at ORNL. Thomas' research interests are in condensed matter physics as well as the development of high-end computing systems for simulation-based sciences. He is the teams that were awarded the 2008 and 2009 ACM Gordon Bell Prizes, and that ran the first productive simulations with sustained petaflops performance. So today, he will talk about the reflecting on the goal and the baseline for exascale computing.
Yep, thank you. Okay. Yes, thank you very much for the kind introduction and also to the organizers for giving me the opportunity to talk about our work or the work I've been involved in over the last 5 or 10 years. And what I will do is, I will actually continue. I would also like to thank the previous speaker to give a very beautiful introduction into the subject. I will use the climate and meteorology subject to reflect on the goal and the baseline for exascale computing. So the application continues to be climate, but I will try to be more generic and really view try to discuss the approach that we have to take as we develop into the future and into exascale computing. And in order to understand the difference to what we did up to now, I really want to just say a few words about what we did at Terra and petascale computing, which most of you, of course, remember or are fully aware of. One thing is we up to peta scale or petaflop scale, we really had flops in mind. And we were using the HPL benchmark as the line against which we measure. And this has come under criticism, but I would like to remind everybody that when the first teraflop was reached in HPL within a year, there was an application. It was running in Oak Ridge, so I'm very well aware of what was going on at the time, a material science application that sustained a teraflop. And the same happened then in pretty much at the same time as the first time HPL was reached at the petaflop performance. There was also an application, and actually several applications that sustained a petaflop at the time. So this flop metric is not necessarily a bad one. We all know is when we draw a line between this line of progress, you see really the applications that go along with the fastest supercomputers and improve performance at the factor 1,000 every 10 years. And you can even go back to the first time a gigaflop was reached, and you will again see in areas like material science around, I think, 88, 89, when Cray introduced the first gigaflop awards, they were given to such applications for sustained gigaflop. So this was the trend. Now, let's switch to the domain that we just heard about, climate. So a colleague at Peter Bauer at ECMWF gave me this slide. And what this shows is actually ECMWF has been measuring the performance of their model, again, in sustained teraflops over the years going back all the way to the late 70s. And then again, you see an exponential improvement, and you see a factor 100 every 10 years, which is still a very impressive improvement and something that makes our scientists happy. But when you then look at the systems, you see these are the same systems that appear on the top 500 and that supposedly in HPL made a factor 1,000 progress every 10 years, and here we only have a factor 100. So you can ask the question, has the efficiency of climate codes dropped a factor 10 every decade? Well, that's the difference between 10 and 1,000, must be somewhere. But I think it's this example, and this repeats in other domains, that leads us really to the realization that we must factor in application performance, real application performance, when we discuss progress towards exascale and use metrics. And so this talk will really, we will use productive codes, we will not use research codes when we discuss performance. So but we still have to set somehow a goal, and we realize today we have somewhere around 20 to 100 petaflop, the fastest system around the world. That means we are, in terms of flops, we are about a factor 10 to 50 away from exascale or exaflop, and so then it makes sense to just say in applications our goal is to reach by, I don't know, in China 2020, in the Japan and the US 2022, 23, to reach a factor 50 more in application performance as we have today. And I believe this is the official goal of the DOE Exascale project. And so it makes a lot of sense. But this leads to two questions. What is the baseline for today's performance when we talk about application performance? Not HPL, we talk about application performance. And the other one is, what is the goal, and will a factor 50 be enough to reach the goal that we have with applications and the scientific goals that we have? And it's these two questions that I would like to discuss now in the next roughly half hour. For the baseline, what I'm going to study is another climate and weather model. It's a regional model called COSMO, and it is from a consortium of 8 weather services in Europe are using this, plus about 50 to 70 university groups or research groups in academia. And we are involved at CSIS because our weather service in Switzerland is using this model, and we at CSIS are operating the model for the codes and the simulations and the systems for MeteoSwiss. So these happen to be the computers we're running for MeteoSwiss. So I'm very familiar with this problem because it has been one of my, I don't know, pleasures and headaches, things that keep me up a night during the night for the last 8 years since I'm at CSIS. What MeteoSwiss is doing specifically is they are a member of ECMWF, so they work, they take the global model from ECMWF, and we've heard beautiful talk on how this works, these global models, and take that as input data, so initial and boundary conditions. They use data from their own measurement stations that they assimilate, and then they run two nested models. One is at around 7 kilometer resolution, and one is at 2 kilometer resolution. And then from this, they produce the weather forecast. And this was running on the spring of this year on this left machine, on one of the cabinets of this left machine. Okay, now, the reason they run at high resolution, so 2 kilometers, is because running at lower resolution in the Alpine region, and Switzerland is in the middle of the Alps, does not make a lot of sense. And so we have a lot of valleys like the ones you see on here, and you can just see if you have like a 10-kilometer model, then you will not see anything anymore. Or even a 7-kilometer model, you will have a hard time to see what's going on in these valleys. That's why they've been working at this kilometer scale resolution since almost 10 years now. But it is, the 2 kilometer is still not perfect. So you take it over a diurnal cycle, the wind measurements, averaged wind measurements. So these, the black curve is the experimental, the measurements, and the blue curve is the prediction from the, what you get from the model. And the two valleys I happen to show, they are along one of the main transportation lines for Europe along the Gotthard Pass, north and south of the Alps. So, you know, it is helpful if you know how the weather develops in those areas, and you know rather well. So it turns out that you can fix this discrepancy when you introduce, you increase the resolution from 2 to 1 kilometer. So I hope here I show those who have questions why these scientists always want to increase the resolution. You know, there's a bloody good reason to do that and to work hard towards reaching that. The other thing that they want, before I go on, of course, increasing the resolution means something in terms of resource requirements. So if you double the lateral grid, you will have a factor 4 in terms of, you know, number of grid points, and so you need a factor 4 at least. But then you need to also double the time step in your integration. And the difficult part about that is, so the grid doubling in itself is a weak scaling problem. So that's not hard. You just throw more resources. The grid, the time step is of course a strong scaling problem, as you all know. And this is going to be one of the challenges as we go to exascale, when we talk later. So overall, you know, the performance increase for this doubling means a factor 10 in performance that we need. Now, in addition, and this is from another example, a precipitation forecast from this a single 2 or 1 kilometer trajectory. And when you slightly modify the initial and the boundary conditions, and you run the simulation multiple times, and you heard it before, then you can see that there can be, you know, most forecasts are very similar, so relatively low precipitation, but there are a few forecasts that actually predict high precipitation. And this is also known as uncertainty quantification, or so you have to find out, you're studying a chaotic system, and you have to basically find out how reliable or how sensitive is your prediction relative to changes in the initial conditions. And now applied to this specific day in summer 2015, again, we have the single trajectory forecast. Then when we look at the ensemble, we have quite a variation in the forecast precipitation. And in this particular case, so usually you're somewhere in the mean, but in this particular case, what happened is one of the extreme events set in, and they had some major flooding and even some landslides in some places. So that brings us to the requirement that what Meteo Suisse wanted, in addition to this increase in resolution, they want to run the simulation multiple times, just as we heard in the previous talk. But of course, if you run the simulation multiple times, you need multiple computers, or you need to multiply the amount of resource that you need. So in summary, Meteo Suisse, what they wanted is, they wanted this 1 kilometer model. They wanted an ensemble running at 2 kilometers. Now, in many other weather forecasting centers, they run the ensembles at much lower resolution because it's cheaper. But as I said, in the Alpine region, it makes no sense. The results are garbage, and if you do garbage statistics on garbage, you get even more garbage. And so the price is relatively high that they had to pay, and then they had to increase data assimilation. So three things they want: higher resolution in a single trajectory, they want an ensemble at this 2 kilometer resolution, and more, and they need to assimilate more data. Now, when we look at what we are expecting in terms of performance increase, we can say, as I explained before, the grid brings us a factor 10. Then the ensemble can run in parallel to that, is another factor 24 when you go into the details. And the data assimilation that you have to do is another factor 6. And so you can add everything together and you get the requirements are a factor 40 over what they had at the time, you know, when we built the previous machine. And the problem was this all had to happen somehow at constant budget and both on the investment side and the operational side. And so the real challenge was, you know, how are we going to bring this down, this factor 40? And this had to happen in about 3 years. Boy, let me do this by hand. Okay, so they wanted to introduce the new product in 2016, and this meant we had to introduce the new system in 2015, and this is, you know, compared to the previous system that we had introduced in 2002, the previous computer. Now, what, and I will derive the baseline question from this, but you can see also in a small scale, we have like the exascale problem. It's not a factor 50, we had to produce a factor 40. So roughly the same. So I hope what I'm going to discuss now is giving you an illustration of what one has to do when we go to exascale. But the problem there will of course be much more severe. So you can say, okay, 3 years is not a lot of time to do to work on this, and you can say, okay, let's just try to beat this with compute, because the computer was small, and we will certainly get help from Moore's law, and so let's deal with it in that way. What I show you here is the machine room at CSCS, and the blue system up there is the Meteo Suisse system that we had on the image. Now you can say, okay, we need a factor 40, and we assume we get help from Moore's law factor 2 over 3 years. That's reasonable, maybe conservative, but when you plan something like this, you have to be conservative. So that means still we need somewhere around 20 times more sockets than the current system. The packaging is improving. The blue system you might have seen is a Cray XE6. That's based on this XT packaging technology, so 2008. And now we are in 2015, 16, so we have Cray XE cabinets, and so that means we can double the density. And we are taking Pitstein, which is this green area there, Pitstein, Pitstora, as the metric in space, what it needs, and we can now say, you know, 20 times more socket than the blue one will lead to this system of this size. So roughly about 10 times the area, and you know, roughly you can say that means the cost will go up a factor 10, the procurement cost, and also and actually may even go a bit more than a factor 10, because Intel is also changing their prices. You know, Moore's law is not really at constant price anymore. The price is going up as well. But more importantly, also the power usage will go up a factor 10. Okay, and clearly, so this was not an option to do this within constant budget. And so on. So we had to really go outside the box. And So the one thing you have in a climate code is, of course, or in actually any application area, is you have the software that you can work with, so the application software, and you have also the mathematics, ultimately, that you can work with, and of course the computer science and algorithms. Now, we did not have much time. We had 3 years to do this. In fact, when we were presented with the requirements in 2013, we had to deliver a machine in 2015, so that was not really a lot of time to make fancy innovation on the math side and on the algorithms. But we had already been working on the software. So this is roughly what the Cosmo Code looks like. You know, you have different parts. In orange is the dynamics, and in green the physics, and those turn out to be, when we take the 2 kilometer, the runtime at 2 kilometer, that's about 80% of the time. The dynamics is about 60% of the time. And so we basically, the option we had is to look at, migrate this legacy code and try to tackle the performance problem on the code side. But the challenge we have here is this is a community code, so we cannot just do anything we want. We had to negotiate with the community, what changes we can make to the code, not to the model, but to the code. And the agreement was that the dynamics, which is considered pretty much a black box, could be rewritten, and quite aggressively, as long as it works and produces the same results. And the physics, we would, I'm really struggling with this thing. The physics would have to stay in Fortran, and would and we would to somehow have to deal with the new architecture. So the goal was really to rewrite, refactor the software, so that we can be more flexible with the choice of architectures. And the decision was rewrite with C++ and template metaprogramming, and be very aggressive on the dynamics, and just use directives on the physics side. And the result, after a lot of work over several years, is we now have two codes. We have the original production code, which is still in use at most weather services, and we have this new implementation that is now in use at Meteo Suisse. And these are no longer a monolithic code, but it is really broken up in libraries. This is not easy, because we are talking about the stencil-based finite difference code, and there is no real hotspot where you can introduce calls to a library and so on. So you had to introduce a domain-specific language and so on. But nevertheless, the most important point was we managed to separate the implementation of the dynamical core from the architecture-specific backends, and we produced two such backends. One is the x86, so for normal Xeon processors, or AMD Opteron processors, and then another one for GPUs, which was a CUDA / OpenACC backend. And we have, thanks to this investment in software, the flexibility of choosing different hardware architectures. So that's what I'm going to discuss next. How do we go about deciding about the hardware? And this is not just important for the baseline, but then also when we look afterwards at exascale computing. The model here is a structured grid, so it would be like one of these icosahedra. You can look at those as a structured model, so it works the same way for these icosahedral meshes. We have a lateral resolution of 1 kilometer, and in the vertical we have roughly, on average, 50 meters resolution. So this anisotropy in the model, and the fact that the model is stratified, those are very important problems. So those of you who are experts in fluid dynamics, you know, this is not the same beast as a DNS simulation in fluid dynamics, even though the equations look the same. Okay, what we have is a mesh, two-dimensional mesh of columns. And what I'm showing here is now a scaling study where we change the number of mesh points that we do on, we put on a particular processor or socket, and then we would have to, in order to run the problem, we would have to adjust the number of processors that we use that we are using. So, in a sense, if we flip the chart around, it looks like a strong scaling curve, where this is just time to solution, and then the number of processors, which is equivalent to looking at it on the amount of work that you put on the processor. Because I want to, I'm assuming we have a strong network, and we do have that, that suffices to keep up with this. But I really want to introduce this notion of the work we have to do on a given socket or on a given processor, because that allows me to have a differentiated view between the different architecture. So for the design of the Meteor Swiss system, we had a production requirement at, I think, around 300 milliseconds per time step. And once you have that, you can then decide to go either set, keep that constant, and then pack as much work as you can on a certain socket. And in this case, you would say, okay, I go and I choose GPUs for my implementation. And the other way is if you have a time to solution problem, that you want to minimize time to solution because you're not happy with the 300 millisecond, then you have to go the other way, and then in this case, the Sandy Bridge processor would win. Okay, but we had to solve more a throughput problem. We were happy with the capability, and that's why we ended up choosing GPUs. And at this point, whether it was GPUs or CPUs didn't matter anymore because the software would work on both. And the result was this machine that HPC Wire and we announced a year ago, because it was put in computational operations a year ago, that was packed with Tesla K80 GPUs. So the result was we stayed in the budget and in the operational and investment envelope, and now we can ask the question, what exactly were the contributions to get this factor 40? So I'm using now a logarithmic representation on the side because it's usually easier to comprehend. We have two implementations of the exact same model that run on the same architecture, x86, so we can run the two and compare. And there, the new implementation, even though the previous one was actually very well engineered and optimized, but the new implementation had almost a factor 2 advantage over this. So sometimes when you optimize code for GPUs, you get the factor 10 or 100 there. Here it's a factor 2 only, and it has mostly to do with changing the loop order because we could, depending on the underlying architecture, choose different loop orders. And the one chosen in Cosmo was based on previous architectures, vector architectures, and so it was not optimal in this case for the x86 CPUs. Then we have mathematical improvements that this is not really just HPC. This is really, you have to understand that when you develop this new resolution, you are fighting with stability issues due to the orography, you know, valleys that you haven't resolved before, resolve now, and this introduces problem. And so this is really where, this is outside of the computing realm. This is the Meteor Swiss that have been working really hard 6 years to make this possible. The fact that we had the new software allowed them to be more productive on the mathematical side and also do things that had performance implications, such as they managed to get it stable running in the dynamics in single precision. So some parts of the physics were still double precision, but the dynamics in the new model is running in single precision, that gives you roughly a factor two. But there were other improvements and also resource utilization. This would work on, you know, in the new code, in the new model, still on x86. Then the change in architecture. So we could now choose GPUs or CPUs, and we chose GPUs, and that gave us roughly an additional factor of two. Then we had Moore's law. So this is comparing the Haswell processor against that we would buy, or yeah, we bought in 2015, comparing against the Magnicourse processor that we had in the previous machine. So that was a bit better than two, almost three. And then in order to make the factor 40, we had to add 30% more sockets. So that's basically how this whole improvement came together. The bonus was that the GPUs running in bandwidth limited mode are using significantly less power than the CPUs. And even though nominally they use more when they run HBL, but this is a different application. So overall, we have an improvement in power consumption that was better than just the time to solution. But the main message, and this is really the message for also for Exascale, there is no single bullet. You work hard and you work across the board. Okay? The key ingredient here is flexibility in software, and really a big investment in software, and then you know, you get a number of places advantages, but you really need a team that understands the architecture, that understands the mathematics, that understands the domain problem you're trying to solve. And I believe this is really a template of what is going to happen to everybody who wants to make drastic changes as you go to Exascale in the next few years. The work is documented. There's a number of people I would like to acknowledge here: Oliver Fuhrer, Carlos Azuma, Xavier Lapion, Tobias Gysi, Ben Cumming, Mauro Bianco, Andrea Arteaga, and Gilles Forestier, Massimiliano Fatica, and also Peter Mesmer, who helped us a lot from NVIDIA. The Stencil Library was published last year at the Supercomputing Conference, and we had a few energy-related studies. And the first paper is really the overview of the development of how to evolve a climate code towards architectural portability. So the question now is, which one is the baseline as we go to Exascale? Do we use the current implementation that most weather services are using, that is also similar to what most climate scientists are using? Is also very similar to, this is COSMO, but WOF is very similar. Or do we use the baseline? So what are we going to improve the factor 50 on? The upper one or the second, the difference is a factor 10 in performance. And a lot of the tricks we pulled, we don't get the second time. Okay, you can do them once. And so that is one of my questions I have to the DOE. When you go in with such a project, you know, where is your starting point? You can make it easy and take the conservative ones, but I'm not sure it will help us as scientists. So in order to know what we really need as scientists, now I want to switch to what is really the goal. And we had the question before, you know, what is the ultimate resolution? And it depends on what you're looking at. I think there is a general agreement in the climate community that you want to resolve convective clouds, and that will require kilometer scale, so 1 kilometer resolution. I have a colleague at ETH Zurich that really showed this very beautifully, that you describe the climate evolution in a statistical way correctly with 1 kilometer. You don't have to go higher if you look at convective clouds. If you want to study fog over things like San Francisco, that's where you have to go to 100 meters, because you have to resolve the large eddies in the boundary layer. Even though it looks simpler, but it's actually harder from a numerical point of view. Whether this is relevant for climate scale, long integration, remains, you know, that's an open question. We have colleagues in Hamburg who believe it is important, and the long-term goal should be a 100-meter resolution. We just heard it in the talk before. And then, you know, just as a game, if you want to resolve like this banner cloud behind the Matterhorn in this case, then you need to go really have the orography right up down to 10 meters. Going from one to the next is a factor 1,000. So 1 kilometer you will see is the challenge for exascale, you know, 100 meters is beyond. That will be zeta scale, if we do our homework right at exascale. And then the 10 meter, I don't think, at least not in my lifetime, probably will not get there. Again, what is very important for the study is that we don't use some benchmark code, but we use the real applications. And what I'm showing here is the kilometer scale resolution is really been a study that has been going on, at least in Europe, for over roughly 15 years. And what you can see is the evolution of the domain size is pretty much the evolution of the computational capabilities. And the difference from Nicolina Ban was using the old implementation of Cosmo on our previous machine, Monte Rosa, and the new implementation of Cosmo starting in 2014 on Pitstein. That's really the performance difference in visualized in okay, so again, I want to remind ourselves, so now I have to become a bit more quantitative when we look into the future. So the model is again this 1 kilometer and these columns. 1 kilometer mesh of 2D mesh of 1 kilometer columns. And they are using in this model a split explicit time stepping scheme. So these are the equations, they get broken up into different contributions. You have the physical tendencies, so this is the parametrization that is somehow computed inside these columns. You have the horizontal advection part, you have vertical advection, and then you have the sound waves, and ultimately you have water advection. And from a time step point of view, the fastest one is this, well, apart from vertical advection, is the sound waves, where they have the smallest time step. Then the vertical advection, that's where you have the grip points very close together, that they are solving with an implicit solver. And then they have the horizontal advection with a slightly coarser time scale. And then you have an implicit solve on the you know, on the physical tendencies which are on the columns. And that's totally very much less relevant in terms of compute performance. The metric that can be basically stated as follows. We simulate in numerical weather prediction up to 10 days, in climate prediction up to 100 years. And then there is something called spin-up of a climate model when they develop the model parameters, and then you want the climate simulation to go much, much faster, 5,000 years, because you have to integrate over timescales of the ocean, and that is thousands of years. The wall clock time is then a few hours at most for the numerical weather prediction. Climate, you don't want to wait much more than a month when you do these 100-year predictions. And even when you spin up a model, you want to do this within, you know, half-year timescales. You don't want to wait 50 years to do that. And that then gives you the ratio that you need, or sometimes they say simulation years per day. I think there is a Gordon Bell paper today or tomorrow that is using this metric. And for us relevant is wall clock time per 10 second time step. So this outer time step in the split explicit scheme at 1 kilometer resolution has to be 10 seconds. And so the wall clock has to be either 100 milliseconds, 10 milliseconds, or 1 millisecond if we you know, want to do these, each of these areas properly. Okay, so this is, and the curves look a bit shaky. So we've been, this is now taking the new code on today's architecture. So we have, as you know from the top 500 presentations, we have a GP100, a very big machine, Pitstein. Then, so we are comparing the model running on the GP100, on the K80, one socket of the K80, and on the K20X, and then on Haswell Broadwell over here. And this will be Sandy Bridge. We need to, you know, really go back and make sure all these benchmarks, they are meaningful. The Sandy Bridge system is moving out of the way, so we didn't have much time to really do this thoroughly. But when you now take these wall clock time requirements for numerical weather predictions, that would be at 100 milliseconds. So, and the, let me see, the climate production of the 100-year prediction is at 10 milliseconds, so this factor 1,000 in compression. And you can see that the if you were to run with this implementation of the model, the global model at 1 kilometer for numerical weather prediction, you would satisfy it with GP100s, the time to solution. And that's really the critical point, because the weak scaling is pretty much, that's relatively straightforward, assuming you have a good enough network. But if we want to do this globally today, we would need 15,000 GP100. So it would be really a heroic system. Cori has 10,000 roughly KNL. We will have to see what performance we get on there, but so it will be 1.5 times the size of Cori, the system to run this. And so it would be, again, outside the capabilities of Meteo Suisse. The challenge is when we go to the climate production, then we would really have to push things down here. Here we are still a factor two off. I'm confident that with more investments in software and very careful implementation, task-based parallelism, exploiting more parallelism than the obvious one, we could probably bring this down. But the scary number is if we implement this on top of on processor, we would need almost 1 million sockets, or in terms of nodes, that's 500,000 nodes, 200 nodes per cabinet, that's like 2,500 cabinets, okay? Titan, in this density, in this packing density, Titan is 100 cabinets. So 25 times Titan, okay? And this is not the end. We need the spin up, we need another factor 10, okay? And so I would say you can basically, from this you can read what the direction is for exascale, okay? Exascale would mean I would like to see the GPUs, you know, to come down without requiring more parallelism, down to a factor 10. But this is really in strong scaling, not, don't add more threads. Or if you add more threads, then somehow do magic with the scheduling of these threads. And then we can do climate in production and all the throughput. For this, over here, particularly if we want to go a factor 10 in time to solution, I don't see any way around to some architecture. You know, I don't know if GPUs will help, whether it is some lightweight core or so. So what is comforting is that when I look at the discussions in Japan or in China or also in the US, they are really going in the right direction. But the message is really for applications to exploit this. The days when you can just use the old code on your x86 processor is definitely, these are over. And if you want to make progress towards these goals that we have at exascale. So in summary, what I really would like to emphasize here is that multidisciplinarity is key to going forward. I've talked about just improving code, but staying within the same algorithm. Of course, we have an option to improve the mathematics and the computational science, and that is probably one area where we have hope that we can, in addition, invest. Then we have software engineering, that was key. I hope I convinced you about this. And of course, computer engineering. And these are really the three key domains that have to come together. And you can now ask, where is applied math and computer science? And in my opinion, it is not one particular bubble, it is really in all of them. You need computer science and applied mathematics. And so that's essentially the main conclusion. Something that probably most of you know, we just need to be take very seriously, and I'm done. And thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much. So actually, we have a running out of time. So one quick question. Any questions? Oh, okay.
I would have a quick question. Thomas, thank you for the nice talk and the details. On the chart with the factor of 40, where you require them and where you get them, could you make a comment where IO is hidden there, please?
IO is, let's see, we have the same, pretty much the same system size. We pretty much had to improve the I/O performance, but that was not the cost-limiting factor in this case. That's the I/O would actually change. I'm not even sure whether it was a factor 40, but the main change in I/O was in the part that does the ensembles. Okay. That's one thing. The other thing, but this is a key question, and I appreciate you asking it, because when we move climate models into the future, we do have consider IO. We will probably do a lot less, in my opinion, writing out to disk. We will do a lot more, if you have a good model that you spun up very reliably, and then you may, on the same machine, generate trajectories, and then you will reproduce those trajectories in a throughput way on the different machines. Bit reproducibility, you have to look at that, I agree, but it's a solvable problem. And then you do basically the analysis not on data you have on disk, but while the simulation is running. That's, in my opinion, the only strategy that I see.
Thanks.
Work now.
Okay, thank you very much again.